Bloodborne was released in March of 2015 as a PlayStation 4 exclusive. It's the fourth entry in From Software's Souls series, and is solely responsible for that name changing to the Soulsborne series. The first was Demon's Souls, a PlayStation 3 exclusive that released in 2009. Then there was Dark Souls 1 in 2011, and Dark Souls 2 in 2014. In many ways, Bloodborne is the best in the entire series. It's definitely the most consistent. If you've watched my prior videos on Dark Souls 1 and 2, then you know my opinion is that both of them are near the same quality. Dark Souls 1 has some incredible sections that are near perfect, but the whole game is brought down by some abysmal parts like Lost Izalith and the encounter with Seath. Dark Souls 2 is more even throughout the base game, but then has a great spike in quality with the DLC. Bloodborne holds firm in how great it is from beginning to end, but doesn't quite reach the same heights as the previous two games when you're comparing their best moments. I suspect that I've already annoyed some people with what I just said. I also suspect that Bloodborne has been placed on a higher pedestal than Dark Souls 1. Whether that's because people want to justify purchasing a PlayStation 4 just to play it, or the fanatical adoration that game director Miyazaki has garnered from many players, and the strange notion that his absence is the only reason that Dark Souls 2 is disappointing. Bloodborne is a fantastic game, but it is not perfect. It brings some massive changes to the Soulsborne series that are largely positive, but it is also a step back in many ways from Dark Souls 1 and 2. And I'm saying this as someone who, after playing Bloodborne several times over the past 2 months, considers it to be the best game in the entire series. It should go without saying that this video will contain spoilers for the entire game, including the DLC. I know the video is long, and if you're put off by that, there are links in the description below so you can watch it in installments. Demon's Souls and Dark Souls 1 both laid down the fundamentals of gameplay in the series, the combat system. You approach enemies and engage in duels that initially feel slow and, for first-timers, maybe even a little awkward. All attacks are tied to longer animations than in most games that require you to commit to your actions and be absolutely certain that you're choosing to attack at the right time. It's not until you play for a little while and realize that enemies also have the same limitation that things start to click. This very simple perception shift is what combat in these games is all about. Mistakes are heavily punished, which means every attack, whether it connects or misses, has drastic results. The idea behind this, as I said in my Dark Souls 2 video, is that all damage has to obey two rules. It has to be predictable and preventable. The reasoning for this is tied to the game's difficulty. Dark Souls has something close to an open world with checkpoints scattered throughout it, bonfires. You can rest here and regenerate resources that you need for healing, a reusable potion that puts a number on how many mistakes you're allowed to make while you travel through the world. Each bonfire checkpoint therefore becomes the starting place for each level that surrounds it. There's almost always a path through a large number of enemies between the starting point and a boss at the end, before you can travel to the next part of the world and reach the next bonfire. The Estus Flask has limited charges that can only be replenished by returning to those bonfires. This turns every level into a gauntlet. You have to fight through all of the enemies to reach the boss while making so few mistakes that you have enough healing charges left to kill that boss. As you get better at the game, you'll need fewer of them for each playthrough. But for newcomers, these healing charges are vitally important for getting through each level. So with this extreme take on how important these healing resources are, and how you lose one every time you make a mistake, you can see that the only way the game can be enjoyable to play is if those mistakes are always your fault. If the gameplay repeatedly and relentlessly goes out of its way to damage you and eat away at those charges without any way for you to predict or prevent that damage, then the whole game falls apart. It's for this reason that I consider the healing systems in these games to be the most important parts of them. They dictate virtually everything about how the game plays. For another example of this, look at how Dark Souls 1 handles multiple enemies in combat. When it's just one-on-one, the best ways to take down your opponent are either to wait for them to attack and then counterattack in that opening, or to use your defensive options to create that opening for yourself. As you get better in the game, you can become more aggressive with pushing these attacks, or learn that rushing them down before they ever get a chance to strike at you is often equally viable. When you're faced against multiple enemies, this all changes. Enemy swing animations can start to come at you staggered, meaning that those openings that you're used to waiting for suddenly don't exist because the second enemy is attacking in those moments when you'd usually counterattack. The best way to handle these encounters is to lose your camera lock on and try to flank your opponents, or run away from them and then cheese their AI by making them both attack at the same time, meaning that they're both open together for a counterattack. Dark Souls 1 knows that this isn't something that it's good at, although it does make you fight multiple enemies many times throughout the game. They're almost always weak ones that die in one or two hits. It's exceedingly rare that the game will force you to fight two dangerous enemies, and when it does, there's usually a good reason for it. Usually. In summary, you can see how this turns every level into a series of challenges that builds on this healing system. levels become a cycle. You arrive at the bonfire, you learn the layout of the level, you discover the path you need to take to reach the boss. You learn the enemies that stand in your way on that path. You have to become experienced at fighting them so you become so good at it that you can reach the boss with enough healing charges left to be able to kill it. There are often shortcuts along the way that reward exploration by having a shorter path from the bonfire to the boss. Before we move on, I just want to briefly state that some people hate this system. You can level up in these games with souls that you collect by killing enemies. When you die, you drop all your souls in a bloodstain on the floor. You go back to the bonfire and have to fight your way all the way back through the same enemies in the same locations. You retrieve your souls and then continue on. It's very similar to corpse running in massively multiplayer games, a genre that is often designed around wasting your time. I disagree with this estimation of the Souls games. The repetition of its content is there to make you master each area and to build tension when you're getting close to the boss. The time investment is to raise the stress level of the fight so that the satisfaction of beating it is also raised when you finally do win. People aren't wrong to dislike it, but I thought it was worth mentioning some of the more common criticism I hear about the fundamentals of the series. So let's look at the sequel. Dark Souls 2 proves how delicate the healing systems are in these games. A relatively small change brought so many alterations to the core formula from Dark Souls 1. I have a video dedicated to just this topic if you're interested after watching this, but it's necessary for me to briefly review the changes before getting to Bloodborne. The Estus Flask is still in Dark Souls 2. In the first game, you only had 5 charges. You could spend a finite resource at bonfires in order to increase this cap to 10, and later to 20 further into the game. In the sequel, you start off with only 1 charge. You increase it by finding Estus Flask shards, which I always took to mean that the flask had holes in it, and you use the shards to fill in the gaps to hold more Estus or something, never mind about that. So already this seems like a massive change, but in reality it doesn't matter all that much. You can find enough shards to get to 12 charges, and you get this many no matter what bonfire you rest at. You no longer need to commit resources to kindling each checkpoint. However, the Estus Flask is largely irrelevant in Dark Souls 2, and looking back, I think it was a mistake to put it in the game at all since it might confuse some players. Maybe it was only included to be used for challenge runs for people who want to forego the actual healing system in the game. You're given life gems early on. Shortly into the game, you find a merchant that you can purchase these from for a very low amount of souls. This is the game's version of regenerating health, and if you excuse the hyperbole, it really does change everything. This focus on battling through long-term gauntlet levels is gone. Instead, it's about the short-term. Battles against multiple, larger enemies are now common because staying true to the predictable and preventable tenets isn't quite as important. These ideals can become eroded because every mistake you make doesn't remove a precious limited Estus charge. You have effectively unlimited life gems to use instead. Fights can now be more complicated, and there's still decision-making to be done with using openings to crush a life gem, which regenerates your health slowly enough that it doesn't destroy the game's difficulty completely. Fighting multiples can still occasionally be awkward, but equipment load has been eased so you can move about a lot faster with armor on, and the effectiveness of your dodge roll can be increased by leveling up a new stat, which as an aside here is a point of contention that many players understandably dislike. The sequel brought many other changes, but I'm trying to keep repetition from my previous videos to a minimum, so I won't go into them here. Let's just briefly acknowledge that maze-like level design with shortcuts wasn't a priority in Dark Souls 2 like it was in Dark Souls 1. Understanding how important the healing systems are in these games is crucial to see how different Bloodborne is, and it allows you to think about some of the less obvious changes that were made, and for some of the reasons that they might have been done. Bloodborne changes so much about this series that you can make a strong argument that it shouldn't be considered a sequel at all, which is really funny to think about considering how similar the games look and feel. You have lamps instead of bonfires, echoes instead of souls, messengers instead of notes on the floor. They have the same sort of open world with checkpoints, enemies, and bosses. The online co-op and invader feature is still there, you leave a bloodstain when you die, basic movement feels identical to Dark Souls 1, even down to the awkward way that you have to strangle the circle button in order to jump. But added to this are so many changes that it makes Dark Souls 1 and 2, games that have been criticized for being too different, look like identical twins. In many ways, I feel like it's an amalgamation of the entire series, including Demon's Souls, that has come together to be more than the sum of its parts. Let's start with the healing system to show this, because I can think of no better example than the Blood Vials and Rally system. You acquire these vials regularly from killing enemies. They drop constantly, just like grass in Demon's Souls. But you can only carry a limited amount at one time. There's a cap on how many charges you can store to correct mistakes, just like the Estus Flask. You can use them quickly and regularly in order to facilitate far riskier play, but it's rallying that's the closest thing to life gems. When you take damage, you have a brief window to strike back at your enemy in order to recover some, or most if you're quick enough, of the life you lost. Like life gems, this means damage you take isn't always going to knock off a bit of your strictly limited healing. So just like the introduction of life gems, this changes so much about the series. Whereas playing cautiously, defensively waiting for safe openings to attack was almost always rewarded in the previous games, all-out aggression is what Bloodborne wants from you. It's truly impressive that they were able to turn the game around to head in the opposite direction with only a few small tweaks like this, but whether or not this is a purely positive change is something I'm unsure about. Unless it's been said in an interview somewhere, there's no way to know what came first. Just like I spoke about in my Dark Souls 2 video, was the focus on multiple slot at first which led to life gems, or were life gems made first which allowed for a looser take on combat? Because similar changes have been made to fights in Bloodborne, enemies are now far more aggressive too. So many monsters will charge at you, lunge at you, there's a lot more instances of enemies that will attack and move at the same time, rather than being locked into a swing animation like in Dark Souls 1. Some enemies worked in a similar way in that game, but they were far more rare. Adhering to those rules of predictable and preventable is harder to do here. There are once again a lot of encounters with multiple enemies, but also multiple highly aggressive rampaging enemies. This is mostly okay because the game has given you updated tools to deal with these changes. The rally system alone is trying to tell you that taking damage isn't that big of a deal, but it's a massive change. This is similar to the focus Dark Souls 2 has on difficulty on the smaller scale, individual battles that you can recover from afterwards, but does that mean it's the same on the larger scale through an entire level? While I'm not exactly sure, the limited blood vials you can carry seem to imply that you're meant to be going through a series of enemies as best as you can in order to arrive at the boss with as much potential healing as possible, right? The issue is that blood vials drop so commonly that it's possible to take a few hits, use some of the charges, and then find more to refill yourself back up to the max by the time you make it to the boss door. I suspect that this was actually trying to fix a problem in Dark Souls 1, just like how I think a lot of the changes made in Dark Souls 2 were there in order to prevent the amount of circle strafing and backstab spamming that experienced players could do in order to steamroll through virtually the entire game. The other problem that persisted, which I think Bloodborne was trying to fix, was how you can just run past all the enemies and go right for the fog door. The one change about healing that I haven't mentioned yet is that blood vials don't refresh for free. They're not like Estus charges. You have to kill monsters to loot them, or you need to gather echoes in order to buy them. On paper, this is an absolutely horrendous change. It forces you to farm for blood vials, farming, something that Dark Souls has never made you do until now. In practice, however, I think the idea here is sound, just the execution is a bit messy. Blood vials drop often enough that it's trying to incentivize you into clearing your way back to the boss door every time you die. It's a different version of the Estus Flask Gauntlet. If you master an area and can clear it comfortably, then you'll naturally be building up a supply of blood vials that you can replenish each time you fight your way back from lamp to fog door. Unfortunately, this system simply doesn't work as well as it should. It's still far safer, and often faster, to go somewhere else to farm vials and then run by all the enemies again to try the boss. This feeds into a lot of other problems in the game, and also the biggest one, that Bloodborne is a very different experience for players new to the series than it is for those familiar with Souls games. Let's pause for a minute here. I want to say a couple more things about the game because a lot of thoughts I have about it are interlinked. First, I want to state clearly that I don't think Bloodborne has any fatal flaws. There's no horrible section that I dread having to force myself to play through. There's nothing about it that completely fails, only a handful of things that fall short. That's a pretty big achievement, and it's not something I can say about the previous games in the series. It's the reason why I think Bloodborne is the best of all of them, even though I think there are standout moments in the previous games that I like more. The biggest of these small problems, however, is the game's difficulty, in more ways than one actually, because I think it's far too easy for players who have played the other games, and that it starts out too difficult for those who are new. It doesn't succeed for either group. Now this is really difficult for me to gauge because it's so subjective, and that I've played the other games for so many hundreds of hours. There was no point in the main game that I was ever stuck. I don't think I legitimately died to any of the bosses more than 3 times, and the vast majority of them I killed on my first try. It wasn't until the more difficult Chalice Dungeons that I finally started feeling challenged like in the other games, and finally ran into that problem with blood vials that I mentioned a minute ago. The healing system doesn't demand the same amount of mastery from you as Dark Souls 1. You can spam attacks through so many areas, enemies, and even some bosses, even some of the later bosses. 20 blood vials is simply too many for experienced players, especially since the rally system can correct many little mistakes, or allow you to ignore attack animations and just blindly carve forward and spam your way back to full health. But on the flip side are new players not having Estus always there to help them through the learning period, that you can end up stuck with this vial debt that you have to farm your way out of, Again, this is hard for me to really know, but I don't think I'm wrong in imagining a new player stuck in Yharnam for hours, dying repeatedly while they go through the prove yourself to the game trial that all newcomers to this series have to put themselves through. Some of you might think that this is necessary for people to understand the game, it's a baptism of sorts so you know what to expect. And I would agree with you, except that the game arguably gets easier after this point. I want to save looking at levels and bosses for the next video, but talking about it is unavoidable here. If you look at the bosses in the main story part of the game, that is, not the Chalice Dungeons or the DLC, then I firmly believe that, if you fight them in level-appropriate gear, that Cleric Beast and Father Gascon are the most difficult bosses in the game for players new to the series. Cleric Beast is essentially Manus for all the jumping and flailing around that he does, and although it's true that it's an easy fight if you know to stay close behind him, a new player isn't likely going to be confident enough to do that. Same with meeting Gascon head-to-head and matching his aggression. I know this is wildly subjective, but I don't think fighting through Yharnam properly prepares you for the playstyle required for these bosses. The game wants you to be somewhat cautious in your exploration and dealing with the normal enemies, but then mouth-frothing, rage-aggressive with these bosses. There's more to these fights, and I'm simplifying the issue in order to leave some things to talk about in the next video, but the real proof for me is that later bosses don't require this kind of playstyle, so it's strange that the ones that are possibly the most alienating are placed here at the start. I don't want to talk too much more about this, but I really am curious to hear from people who played Bloodborne as their first game in the series. Am I right about this? What parts did you struggle the most on? The second big issue is a technical one, and it ties into how the bonfires and Bloodwild farming work in the game. That it's a PlayStation 4 exclusive, no, I'm just kidding. The load times are too long, and I say this as someone who didn't play the game until after they had been reduced in a patch. I'm told they used to be twice as bad, and if I had played back then, I would consider that to be the game's only fatal flaw. What I don't understand is that surely this must have been known early on in development. The central hub of this game is like the one in Demon's Souls, it's a separate area that you can only access through bonfire teleports. It's not an actual physical part of the rest of the world like Firelink Shrine or Majula. Similarly, you can't teleport between lamps, so in order to go from one location to another, you have to load back to the Hunter's Dream, then waddle over to the appropriate teleport stone, which doesn't have visual thumbnails as a guide like in Dark Souls 2, and then sit through another load screen. If you're farming for blood vials, this brings the total to 4 load screens to go somewhere and then return to where you started. But it gets even worse since you can't reset a level by resting at a lamp. You have to see a load screen for that. So you either need to purposefully kill yourself to get sent back, or use an item, or teleport back to the Hunter's Dream and then return again, just so all the enemies will respawn. I still don't understand why the system in Dark Souls 1 isn't just used again. Let me level up at bonfires. Give me other reasons to return to the hub. Don't slow me down with all this unnecessary waiting. Add to this that Bloodborne is a game meant to be challenging. Again, my sympathies go out to new players who had to sit through all of these load screens while they went through the meat grinder that is the first learning hours of the series. It's like the game was developed without any consideration for any of the technical limitations whatsoever, which can also be said for the game's frame rate. Look, the game is gorgeous. There are other games that look better in terms of, say, realism, but if we're talking about art style and atmosphere, then Bloodborne is easily the best looking game I have ever seen. But I can't help but think that all of the clutter strewn through every level could have been reduced by half without losing much of the effect. 30 frames per second didn't bother me as much as I thought it would, but then I'm the kind of person that would have to actually experience it at 60 frames before I could judge it for sure. But the few moments that it dipped below that were terrible. It also sometimes feels like the PlayStation is about to die from the strain of running the game. Combat in Bloodborne is arguably an even bigger departure from the healing system in the previous games. There's a decent sized list of changes that you could read through, but I think the most obvious change is an iconic one. You don't have a shield anymore. There is a shield in the game, but it's so bad that it's more like a message telling you not to expect to find a usable one anywhere. This is why I was hesitant to say anything firm about dealing with the game's difficulty, because if you're the kind of Souls player that used a shield in every single one of your runs in the prior games, then Bloodborne might be enough of a departure for you to feel uncomfortable and new again. With all the rest of the changes, that sort of player might even have the best time going through it all. Some reviewers have criticized the game for removing shields, or the more vague, a lack of defensive options. I don't agree with this statement. The game is giving you different options, not fewer ones. You just have to be willing to experiment and learn some new things. I think that calling the game Bloodborne and not Dark Souls 3 was one of the best things that From did. It encourages you not to think of the game as just more of the same. That said, I was guilty of this on my first playthrough. Weapons are handled differently in Bloodborne, and this change is one of the best in the game. Trick weapons are wonderful, it might be my favorite feature in the whole thing. They have two modes that you can toggle between, each with their own moveset. This is in addition to carrying around a gun in your offhand, so you effectively have three different offensive options on your character with only two weapons equipped. My first time through, I chose the Hunter Axe. About 10 minutes into the game, I transformed it into two-handed mode, and that was me for the whole game. I didn't use the gun, I never felt any need to parry, just two-handed axe all the way from beginning to end. I had a good time and thought I was playing the game somewhat close to what the developers envisioned. The reason for this is how the game handles multiple enemies. Without shields, your options for defending until you get an opening to attack are limited. You can lose the lock-on and play the game like it's Dark Souls 2, but with the trick weapons gaining more range when transformed, you'll have a better time using that longer range to swipe down groups of enemies. This turns the game into less about counterattacks and more about zoning, making sure you're at a safe distance and really learning how much reach your weapons have. Weak groups of enemies become simple to deal with, and it's satisfying enough to go through. However, it wasn't until later playthroughs that I fully enjoyed the depth of the combat system. In Dark Souls 1 and 2, weapons were pretty good. You could commit a lot of time to learning how they all worked and even do full runs with a certain type. Bloodborne takes this to another level with the transformations, since it allows you to fluidly change between two different sets, but also incorporate those switches into combat itself. These trigger their own types of attacks that you can use mid-fight in extremely satisfying ways once you learn how they're best used and chained together. I know this can be summed up as simply just having more options, but they really add a lot and mesh well with the other changes. Learning how every attack works and which direction it goes in, whether it's an overhand, a poke, or a sweep, is really important and really rewards experimentation. Your defensive tools are more about dodging, but there's no more equipment load at all. You stay fast and mobile. When you're locked on, you have a dash. When you're not, you have a roll. I think this is a pretty clever way of telling the player that staying locked on isn't always for the best, and you should be mixing both of these together. If you haven't played the game, I can't think of a good way to communicate just how enjoyable all of this is. Darting in and out, switching weapon modes, attacking, breaking locks, rolling away, I used the same weapons for hours and was still learning new little ways to sneak in extra hits or when the best time transformations against enemy types. The gun slot helps a little, but it's a feature I'm torn on. It's not something I used a lot until my third playthrough, when I specifically went out of my way to test it. This is the game's version of parrying. It doesn't quite make as much sense in this game though. In Dark Souls, you have to actually parry, meaning your shield deflects an attack away from yourself, ruining the enemy's strike and exposing them. Since it's a gunshot in this game, it should make more sense that you shoot them just before they attack, when they're committing power into the weapon and can be knocked off balance, but it's the same timing as before, when the attack is coming at you. Unless your character is shooting the weapon away, I don't know, it's just a minor gripe. Anyway, parrying is a hell of a lot easier in Bloodborne for a few reasons. Although the game compensates a little for this by limiting your ammunition, which you have to spend health on if you want to keep using it. You can fire your gun at any range, which means you don't have to be close enough to get hit by your opponent's attack if you mess up the timing. I also feel like that timing is a bit more generous than it is in previous games. Most of all, however, is that if you shoot too early, many enemies will still be interrupted even if it doesn't trigger the parry opening, so there's even less risk involved. This could be seen as a good thing. I'm undecided. Firing the gun doesn't cost stamina. It pauses your regeneration, but it's quick enough that it can still be used as a break to get some stamina back between attacks. There are also a lot of bosses that you can spam shots on until you finally trigger a parry, which then does an incredible amount of damage. It ties into what I said about difficulty. For another example, we can look at the difference in how backstabs are handled. You have to charge up a big attack aimed at an opponent's back, which, if it lands properly, opens them up to a backstab. This rewards good use of opportunities in committing to a big attack that otherwise might end up with you getting smacked away. It also gets rid of the ambiguity that the past games had with backstabs, where you weren't sure if the game thought you were properly behind an enemy or not until you actually hit the button. Sometimes this could get you killed through no fault of your own, although it was rare. But as good as all these combat changes are, it doesn't change how playing as aggressively as the game seems to want you to trivializes a lot of the challenge. There are many encounters that I simply got through by spamming attacks wildly and firing my gun every so often. You can easily spam your way into a parry and win just like that. For many enemies, like the werewolves, it's the best strategy available to you. Just keep on attacking because it locks them into a stagger chain from your first hit all the way to dead. This is a real problem because the game won't challenge many fans of the series until they get into the New Game Plus ranks or the harder Chalice dungeons. You could say that this is fine since eventually every player will organically reach a point that challenges them, but part of the thrill of these games is conquering new bosses and areas and wondering what's next after finally getting through it all. In New Game Plus, you've already seen everything. I'm not sure what's the true culprit here. The faster pace in combat might have led to fears that the game would be a lot harder. Damage isn't quite as predictable or preventable when it all moves as quickly. Some might say a lower cap on blood vials could fix it, or higher boss HP. Personally, I think some sort of difficulty mode, whether that's on the title screen or something like the Covenant of Champions within the game, should be mandatory going forward to help this problem. Something that changes parts of the game and doesn't just buff monster health and damage. On the opposite side of this are the very few moments when the game becomes unfair. Now, aside from your first encounter with Frenzy and arguably one part in Old Yharnam, I can't think of a single moment that's a gotcha death like some in Dark Souls 1 and 2, so I love the game for that. It doesn't resort to any of these cheap gimmicks, but some enemies in this game suffer from the same problems that have plagued the entire series: broken hitboxes and tracking attacks. I want to say again that Bloodborne doesn't have any huge flaws. These problems are moderate frustrations that didn't happen often. It's just like some of the difficulty spikes throughout the game that are sudden enough to give you whiplash. I've seen other people encounter more hitbox issues than I did while playing, but there are a few cases that ruin some of the better bosses in the game that I'll go into detail in the next videos when we reach them. For tracking attacks, the discussion becomes more complicated. This is something I actually wanted to speak about in Dark Souls 2. Some of you watching might think that tracking attacks are fine. They're in the game to make some monsters difficult to dodge. They also discourage circle strafing. The argument goes like this: tracking attacks work because they test your reactions by making you have to dodge at a more precise time rather than simply dodging as soon as you see that an attack is winding up. I agree with this, but like so many other things, it's how it's done that matters. I think most people would agree that if your dodge needs to be frame perfect, that the game is expecting too much. At 30 frames per second, you need to have your timing down to just that, 1/30th of a second. I've done a little bit of research on the topic, and I'm confident in saying that reacting to that is simply impossible. Of course, timings in these games aren't purely reactionary. If you learn an animation, you can hit your dodge ahead of time to line up invincibility frames or to avoid it completely. But even then, some attacks can be seen as broken. Here's an example, this beggar that turns into a big monster found halfway through the game. He has several attacks that I have a hell of a time dodging. He's one of about three enemies in the entire game that I can't dart my way around and kill without taking damage. If you slow some of these attacks down, you can see that he becomes Mr. Elastic from the Fantastic Four when his attack completes here. I don't think this is reasonable, and I wish the game didn't do it. Other enemies do similar things. The ones I'm unsure about are those who have multiple fast-hitting attacks that have very short warnings. These basically mean that you don't have time to notice what attack it is, only that one is coming and that you need to dodge away. If these are coupled with other attacks that require precise dodge timings, you're essentially flipping a coin when you dodge on whether you're going to take damage or not, whether the attack is one that comes immediately or one that you have to wait for. Another small issue are attack combos that do damage to you even when you've been knocked to the floor and should be invulnerable, or time up perfectly that they hit you again as soon as you get back up before you have control of your character. The answer to all these is either usually don't get hit at all or get good, but I'd argue that a lot of the changes made by the game involve you trading attacks between enemies. There's meant to be this back and forth. In the end, it's the only thing about the gameplay that's legitimately disappointing. I might miss the tension of deciding whether or not I should push onto the fog door or go back to the bonfire without risking it, and when it comes to fighting through waves of enemies to get to the boss, a few cheap attacks can be forgivable along the way. But it's the departure from predictable and preventable from the bosses that hurts the most. It rewards frantic spamming and ultimately becomes neither that enjoyable or challenging because of it sometimes. The combat system here is the best in the series. I just wish the healing system and bosses were all about making me truly master it, instead of getting away with sloppy decisions. I have a lot more to say on this game, some of which expands on what's said in this video. This is just the first of three. The next one will be a walkthrough of all the levels and bosses in the main game. I want to stress that it might be a little tedious for those really familiar with it, since I'll be describing a lot of what happens in each level while also doing some commentary on what I like and dislike. Not every boss and level is super interesting or cleverly designed. It should be available in a few days unless something went horribly wrong with the upload. In the meantime, I have a few other videos on the series that you can watch if you're interested. The audio is a little rough on them, but they're watchable, at least I think so. Please subscribe to the channel if you'd like to see more like this. I also have a Patreon if you want to support future videos. I try to put out three every month. Hopefully I'll see you in a few days for the next one. Thanks.